Hey everyone, it's Gordon Einstein again. I am reaching out to you from my semi-lovely Dubai hotel room. Semi-lovely. Don't ask me why it says France behind me. Whatever. I guess it's giving the international flavor. I want to welcome my wonderful guest, Mohammed Mahfood. I'm learning all these names of all my wonderful people around me. Mohammed was kind enough to reach out and also be recommended to me as a local and global expert on the subject of security tokens, and we'll go into what that's all about and his origin story and projects. But first, I want to give a big warm hello. So Mohammed, thank you so much for coming on this Crypto Wednesday's flash interview. It's a pleasure to have you.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me and giving me this opportunity. It's a pleasure.
Thank you very much. So let's talk about, before we even go into projects and geography and all that other stuff, just tell us for context, something about you, both what you're doing now, and but kind of how you got there and what piqued your interest. And by the way, I reserve the right to interrupt at any time and just, you know, just kind of roll with it. So go ahead, please.
Sure. I've done a few things, but most of my career was in the startups. So I spent, I would say, at least 15, 20 years working on startups, advising, investing as an angel investor, and also working and representing angel investors. Mm-hmm. Most of my work, I was blessed that I have had the opportunity to work on every continent, I would say.
But I got to ask, including Australia?
Including Australia. I still have an operation in Melbourne.
Okay, very nice.
So I spent long hours flying back and forth to Melbourne for some time. Mm-hmm. Latin America, we still have operation. Part of my team is in Colombia and Brazil. We have an office in Chile. But most of my time was in Europe. So that's where I spent most of my professional career, working with startups in Europe and taking them to the US for an exit. And that's what led me to this. I mean, part of, I think 2013 or 14, I can't remember, we invested in a blockchain and a Bitcoin exchange. Mm-hmm. That was like an initial introduction. I wasn't very much into it back then, busy with other things. And then slowly, you know, we started looking to what these things are, mm-hmm. and looking to the blockchain. And I got more involved in 2016. And then, of course, with the ICO period, we had a few interesting projects, raise lots of money.
I always think it's interesting when people use the word interesting, because that's always shorthand for a novel.
I wish I raised for myself, but anyway. So
yeah, fair enough.
I mean, back then, you know, Dubai was, and I think Dubai still is a hub for these things. So in 2017, Dubai was buzzing, you know, so it was difficult not to be involved. Now, the real thing that really attracted me to this is my previous work with the startups. You know, the issue with especially startup and angel investment is your money is stuck for a very, very long time. Mm. And, you know, Silicon Valley has much more exits, better exits for early stage investors. It is not the situation in the Middle East. And, you know, it's better in Europe, but it's not like the US. So
you're
looking for 5, 6, 7 years. Unless if you are involved, and that's what we used to do. We were very involved in these startups, and you know, we were engineering and making the exit so that we can get our money out within 2 to 3 years. But for, let's say, a normal investor investing in these startups, you gotta wait. There is nothing you can do till the management and the board and, you know, the people driving these companies make that exit. So when the
let me jump in for a sec. So I'm familiar with the U.S. capital markets. I understand that Europe is not quite so fast in the Middle Eastern region in general. How does the exit happen? Like, what's the normal way that the original founders or participants exit? Is it an IPO? Well, is it a buyout? Like, what kind of paint a picture for me?
It's Series B and above. So let's say for even later, you know, I there are lots of projects in the market that the early stage investor, the seed investors, mm-hmm. you know, the angels, they really wait for a very long time. So it's difficult to exit within, let's say, 2 years. There are certain projects, but not enough. So even here in the Middle East, you'll notice that the angel funding is not as big as it is outside, mainly because the angel investors, they don't get the exit very quickly. Now, in Silicon Valley, the ecosystem is there. The Series A and Series B and, you know, the VCs recognize the benefit of the angel investors. So they would like them to exit and get some benefit, as well as they want to clean up the cap table and, you know, have a much more consolidated. We see this less in the region. Mm. However, in the last 5 years, things are really looking better and improving. So now you would see much more understanding from the Series A and B. I would say Series B and above. Most of the VCs in the region are looking at Series B and above. So the early
stage. You're saying interesting stuff. So I got to jump in. Why do you? I think I'm hearing you say that there's a seed investors present, there's B and above present. Why would you say there was a gap in the A tranche?
No. Seed and A is difficult. B is more here in the region.
Okay.
So the early stage seed investment, pre-Series A and Series A are more difficult than Series B and above.
Okay.
So for various reasons, of course, one of them is the ability to do the valuation. You know, the exits for the early stage is one of the issues. The ecosystem, the community is not well developed. And however, it's getting improved year after year. Even 2020 was relatively very good for the angel investment and the crowdfunding. I was involved in that domain for a very long time. Mm-hmm. And we analyzed the behavior of the people in this region. And one of the key things we found is that the exit, you know. So me as an angel investor, I put 10,000 or 100,000, whatever. Usually you'd like to see it within 2, maybe 3 years. Mm-hmm. Some people would like to wait till, you know, an IPO or a major, you know, acquisition. Mm-hmm. But the majority would like to, you know, get the cash faster and then they deploy it in other projects. So that is not fully developed yet. And that was very interesting, even in Europe. I mean, the projects we invested in, we exited only if we are involved. So it's sometimes very difficult to be involved in every project to find the, you know, the potential exit. So we do a seed investment, usually an early stage, pre-Series A, and we try to exit as Series A or Series B as a small, you know, investors. Mm-hmm. And it was a difficult journey. You know, we have to take it to the US. You know, we have a network of, you know, acquisition partners there so that we organize that exit. The moment that, for example, you step away from leading this process, then you have to wait, you know, and usually the wait is about 5 to 7 years. And that really with the ICO and then the concept of the security tokens, it just made sense, like, to me. I know things will take time to get developed, but it's perfect. So as a seed investor, if I put money and that money is a security token, and let's say within a year that token is listed, I have a potential of exit. Whether there is liquidity or not, that's a different story. But that option is attractive enough for lots of seed investors.
Well, at the very least, you have the technical capacity to exit.
Exactly.
If there's a market for it, it's a different question. But
I mean, it's getting developed. And see, Now, what I'm doing now, so we set up this company, Deca4, and we're focusing to provide advisory for our clients to do security tokens. Mm. And we do other tokenization, we look into different projects, but we focus on security tokens. And we always get asked about the liquidity. And people compare security token to the public market. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a good comparison because it's, you know, you're talking about 2-3 years old industry, you compare it to 100-year-old, you know, well-developed and very, you know, whether efficient or not, I mean, that's, you know, subject to debate, but the public equity market is definitely, you know, high in liquidity and very efficient compared to a private industry. So I compare the security token to the private equity. So if I look at it from that angle, it's an improvement. So with a private investment, I am literally stuck for whatever period that the management or the people in that private company decide for the next exit. I cannot control it.
Actually, let me, so you're articulating something that I guess makes sense, but I haven't heard it put quite that way before. Let me repeat it back to you to make sure I'm hearing correctly. That's an interesting little observation. The idea that with these security tokens, people are implicitly comparing them with the public market, which is a pretty high standard, pretty tough to reach. You're right, it's been around for hundreds of years. And so maybe that's a nice ultimate goal, but really the proper apples to apples comparison, not apples to oranges, would be the current market for private equity or private securities and whether we can make do an improvement vis-a-vis that reference point. And you're right, security tokens, when you compare against that, of course, you know, I guess you can say it's a lower bar, but it's probably the more applicable bar. So that's an interesting way of putting it.
Yeah, see, any new technology, whether you want to call it disruptive technology or use any terminology, there is a concept of incremental utility. So, I mean, and I think that the practitioners in the industry, lots of people in the crypto community, they are very doubtful of the security token because, again, they compare it to the public equity. So, you know, these, let's say, T0 with the tokens listed there, what is the performance? $500 million market cap. I mean, come on, it's still nothing. I don't look at it this way. I look at it, you know, it started at 20, 30 million beginning of 2020, reached 500. So it's a high growth and it's growing and it's happening. Okay. Now you take T0 or Blockchain Capital or Spice VC or any of these tokens that are listed, you know, what is their volume? Nothing, you know, 1 million, 2 million a month. You know, that's where people say, oh, you know, if I compare it to a Tesla or, you know, whatever stock in the NASDAQ, it's not even applicable, you know, but if I compare it.
Well, how about this? If you compare any other stock in NASDAQ to Tesla, it's going to look bad. Okay. So
maybe wrong.
I'm just kidding around, but I know what you mean. Okay.
Yeah. So, and that's what I've seen because we work with angel investors. We work with these investors and we understand the psychology of what they are looking for. So if I look at it from that aspect and saying, okay, and I have to be very careful in what we say there is a potential of exit, there is a potential of liquidity, it is not there yet, but it is better. So we look at it from where we stand today in a private investment. Mm-hmm. I give it 15, 20, up to 30% better in terms of, you know, discount ratio or valuation for the company, because it is an improvement from private investment going hopefully to the public investment. And I think it will be even much better than the public market in the next 5 to 10 years because it allows you to do things differently. Because now you have cross-border listing with the tokens. You have a company in the US that's privately listed, you know, private company listing their tokens in Seychelles as an example today, allowing anybody from around the world, you know, accredited or qualified investors to participate. And slowly, slowly, the definition of qualified investors, you know, the KYC requirements, AML, everything is converging to allowing masses of people to participate, not at the latest stage. Mm-hmm. And also the other thing with the security token, it's not publicly listed. I mean, you invest in the Apple and the Tesla, it's already listed. Now, to get into the early stage is difficult, as we all know, you know, you know. The crowdfunding and the incubators and the angel networks around the world, you know, it's a difficult game, to be honest. And for angel investment,
I'm going to do my interrupting thing. You know, in the US, at least, it's been a source of vast frustration to me as a lawyer who works in this area, the hobbled Regulation A+ process and the hobbled Regulation CF crowdfunding process, both they're, at least with A+, especially with CF, the low 1 million cap, I mean, they're raising it now. It was just ridiculous. And the amount of paperwork required for both was ridiculous. And it's like, this, you know, the A+ was supposed to be a mini IPO. Well, yeah, it is a mini IPO because you have to do, you know, this huge statement. It's not really making things easier. And my personal feeling is that kind of crypto and security tokens are rushing to fill the gap that regulation has failed to provide or allow for. So yes. I guess I'd like to hear your sense of that.
Yeah, see, like the CF and the Reg A+, you know, not only the amount you raise, but the amount per investor, you know, there is a limit.
Right, right.
You know, very low limit. And UAE, for example, the only jurisdiction that gives you crowdfunding is the IFC, and it's very similar. It's $5 million total raise, and I don't know what's the limit per investor, but there are so many limitations that don't exist in the security token. Mm-hmm. Now, security token with the full compliance, the KYC, you see the ecosystem being developed. You see more KYC companies, providers, and there will be more innovation into that compliance domain. Allowing cross-border transfer jurisdictions around the world are changing the regulation to fit, because it's a different, the technology give you a tool that didn't exist before. So regulators, and the good thing, and I have to give credit to regulators around the world, where people are always attacking them, I think now they are willing to listen. They're saying, come, tell us, educate us. So UAE, beginning of November.
Is that because they got kind of slapped enough, or because they... or because new people came in, or it's competition, or why?
No, it's competition. Countries around the world want to attract businesses. That's not a secret.
Yeah.
UAE, Dubai is working hard to attract businesses. They are changing the regulation, encouraging people to come. It's definitely a competition globally, where people want to have, hubs. That's not a secret. And regulators are smart enough to know there is a limit. I mean, this is a very complex technology. How will it operate in 5 years? Honestly, it's difficult to predict. So I give the regulators credit for them saying, come and present to us. Let's talk. So
can I ask you a question?
Yes, please, go ahead.
So we did a little very brief chat before we started recording, and you made a point that I think everyone should keep in mind, which is even though you're based in Dubai, you have a global scope. I mean, you're literally, like you said, been on all these continents. You have a globally dispersed team. But you also made an interesting comment that I want to hone in a little bit, which is the ability to transfer tokens amongst different jurisdictions, which to me speaks to a coordination of national regulation that's reasonably tight. In the middle, obviously in the United States, inherently you have that because you have one government. In the EU, you sort of have that because they're coming together. In China, so big, you essentially have that. In the GCC or the MENA region, are you seeing intergovernmental coordination that's meaningful, or is that still kind of coming when it comes to security tokens and this blockchain environment?
Well, security token is way too new, globally, and definitely new in the region. So UAE is the first to introduce regulation. They introduced this beginning of November, so about 2-3 months ago. And only about a week or so, they announced for companies to present and to submit applications. Mm-hmm. That's under the main security and commodity authority, the onshore, the mainland. Because as you know, UAE has multiple jurisdictions, ADG in Abu Dhabi, the IFC, and ISCA. So ISCA already now introduced the security token law. In other regions, of course, people talk about blockchain, and I don't know what regulation they need in the blockchain, but let's say they have either an acceptance of utility token or, allowing people to submit and to discuss. So Bahrain has an ahead of the game in the fintech and the, let's say, crypto generally, without, specific to any like security token or utility token. But you could talk to the central bank, you could talk to the regulators, and there is a way to do it. ADGM as well, it's a bit more complex. Now, between countries, the only thing we saw between, let's say, UAE and Saudi Arabia is this central bank digital currency, for example. They created a currency called ABR that will allow the governments between the UAE and Saudi Arabia to settle, the government transactions, which is a step, because, this thing takes time, and you need to take these pieces and build them together.
Sure.
So adopting by the governments, looking into it, even as an experimental phase, is still very good and very advantageous. And the token and cross listing is still not there. I mean, US, there is, of course, the foreign listing concept with the SEC that allows, and one company use that license to list a token outside of the US. We will definitely see this, and passporting of the listing of different jurisdictions. You will see more adoption of the security token in Europe. Luxembourg, about a week or so, announced a very new regulation that allow you to create a native token company.
Yes,
and they allow you to have the whole the cap table, everything in the blockchain, and you don't need the backup of the paperwork. And they will recognize it. So you're going to see lots of this happening.
I think we need to take a moment to appreciate Luxembourg.
Yes, right? Luxembourg. I mean,
that's pretty, You know, Delaware, I've done a decent amount of work in Delaware, and Delaware has that on the books, but it hasn't done it. You know, Luxembourg, that's a pretty big leap.
No share company, right? Concept in Delaware?
I'm speaking broadly, but you know, there is the idea of a blockchain-based stock registry, which, you know, it can be the original reference source as opposed to the paper, or as opposed to being a reflection of a paper. They haven't created a full blockchain-based corporate structure. So let me be a little bit more specific. But you know, the fact it sounds like Luxembourg went the extra mile. I need to actually look at that. It sounds like, if I'm hearing you correctly, it sounds like Luxembourg went the extra mile, and in essence, moved entirely beyond the paper structure and for everything involved with the corporate governance, and decided it could all go on blockchain, if I'm hearing you correctly.
Yes. So yeah, they're accepting a token as a legal tender, basically. Liechtenstein did an experiment already. And Germany has, I'm not sure about it, but the concept of having the registrar, you know, the cap table to be registered on a blockchain, you know, through third-party approved companies. So again, the ecosystem is there are lots of complexity. What we're going to be seeing is more and more of these regulations, technology, and the technology will help the regulator. So somebody might come with a better KYC system, for example. Mm-hmm. So if it makes sense, I'm sure regulators will, you know, adopt it. And you know, if we solve the KYC issue, which is a big problem globally, which is a key requirement for the STOs, for the security tokens. Mm-hmm. And that's why the crypto community preferred the utility token, because you could trade, you know, you don't need to go through that hassle of registering and getting approval.
If it's but a true utility token.
Yeah, I mean, again, without touching on the usage or the legality of anything, but eventually the massive wealth is in the assets and the companies and the real estate, and that has to go through a security token. So
let me pause you. So just because we're in this flash interview format, I want to have you dive in. You're starting to go there. Can you dive in on your consultancy, the projects you're working on? And then you mentioned something very interesting about real estate in our sort of pre-discussion. So I want the audience to understand you're the guy when it comes to X, what kind of things you're working on, and how they can reach you.
Sure. As I mentioned to you earlier, we are an independent consultancy. We don't have a platform. We don't have a technology on purpose, and we're not regulated. So we're not a broker dealer, and we're not planning to do that. So we represent the client. You know, we study their business. We identify the different pieces, technology, you know, issuing token platforms, KYC providers, and we put the pieces together. We manage the whole process. We look at it in a traditional way. So I have a team of business consultants, financial modeling. We review the materials. We understand the business. We work sometimes, enhance the business plans if needed with the clients. Mm-hmm. We have multiple projects. One is a company in the US that has a COVID-19 vaccine candidate, for example. It's an interesting project because it's a private company. Now you cannot invest in vaccine companies because most of them are public or too big. This is an opportunity for people interested. It's a very niche. We're working with Latin American investors. You know, we have an angle to Latin America. We're selling the vaccine to encourage the investors. But so we're tokenizing a traditional equity. It's a convertible preferred equity, mm-hmm. US company, a Delaware setup. And then, you know, you have a token representing that. So that's one project. Another one is a technology decentralized Internet of Things. We have a fund for food, which is, you know, like the new trends in the food, you know, the non-animal proteins and, you know, the different type of, you know, food products that
I like animal protein, but you know, now everyone will hate me. Okay. Yeah.
What, sorry?
I said something evil, which is I like animal protein. But
I like animal protein. So
hopefully everyone, you know, one thing that's good about Dubai is there's lots of kebab and everything else. And, you know, I think I gained a baby down here just eating the good Lebanese. You know, there's a Lebanese restaurant, Jabura, I always go to now.
I can give you a list of very nice places after
that.
Yeah,
please,
this,
so. please. But go on.
Anyway, so, yeah. I mean, yeah, but again, it's a business and people like it. We have real estate projects. We have, you know, sport clubs. So different things, and some of the projects are mixed of utility and security tokens. So it's not, there is a concept of utility if it makes sense. If it doesn't make sense, so what we do is study, we make sure things make sense, and then we work with lawyers around the world to select the right jurisdiction and ensure everything is done in a proper way. So our role is like project management, you know, and we navigate, we help the clients to develop the whole process. Mm-hmm. We have a team in-house. I have a team in Colombia and Brazil and Ukraine and Romania and UAE. Mm-hmm. But then we use a network of advisors, mostly lawyers, tax experts. You know, you need to look into all of that to develop the whole project. As of now, all our projects are not public domain, so we don't go and advertise. I mean, we have a network of investors. You know, these are very niche projects. And we present to the investor a traditional equity and then the token as a registration method. Because mm-hmm. you need to take the people's mentality into stages, you know. I mean, if I go and say, I'm gonna, you know, you're investing in a security token, it gets rejected. So we focus on the business, they understand it, like the US company is a convertible preferred equity with an 8% coupon, so that's the offering. They look at the financials, if they like it, great. Then, by the way, there is a token which gives them a benefit. And we explain to them that token has an advantage. They don't need to bother mm-hmm. about it because we have a custodian with our Coinbase or other ones that the token will be kept with them. So the investors at this stage are looking at things as what they are familiar with. And this is very important for the industry. You have to take things into a gradual incremental phases. Mm-hmm. I mean, the crypto community understands security token. They might like it or not, it's a different story. But then the traditional investors, they get scared. So we have to take that approach. And it's working because people are interested and funds are being raised. We have the real estate project in Dubai. We did securitization, which is, you know, we created an asset-backed security. And then we tokenized that security. So we're not tokenizing the real estate directly. And we're not tokenizing an equity in an SPV. So slightly different approach.
Sorry, you know, you know, at the very beginning of this, you pointed out that there's a still developing seed and A round in this area part of the world, and B forward seems to be pretty well handled. Are you saying also that this security token process or security registration process can maybe jumpstart or catalyze the formation to kind of fill that gap? I mean, maybe you were clear about that. I'm just now putting it all together. Is that a sort of a way to leapfrog over the normal development process and maybe get it in place faster and more efficiently?
I think security tokens, if presented properly, because there is a huge marketing effort, we're doing some, we cannot, of course, we're a small company. Mm. One thing I believe in, I used to work for, let's say, with Crypto Forum and different angel networks.
Yeah, sure.
So we're trying to partner with these people to educate the angel investors that the security token is not an alternative, it's an addition to what they are doing, and it gives them an easy access. So yes, what you said is true. I also believe the crowdfunding platforms will migrate to a blockchain platforms mm-hmm. and then become a tokenized platform, because crowdfunding today is very localized and very limited, as we discussed, you know, the amounts and the number of investors. So I think crowdfunding, the way I look at it, I could be totally wrong, crowdfunding in the next 3-4 years will be one of the major hubs for security tokens, because they already have the investors base. They have thousands of investors putting small tickets. So the mentality is there. The technology will change. And then instead of just investing, normally they get a token, which is, you know, tradable, and they have a better exit. So I believe crowdfunding platforms are moving into tokenization. They are a very good ground for making the security token become more adapted. People say that the institutional investors will jump into the security tokens. Yes, now the banks are doing security tokens, but the institutional investors have so many options. Mm. You know, they have the public market, they have bonds, while the private small investors, they don't have all of these options. So it's more attractive to the crowdfunding angel investors than to the other ones.
Very interesting. For better or for worse, we're kind of banging up against our flash interview time limit. You know, this is an early taste or preview of, I think, a series of longer conversations. I'd love to have you on one of our main show panels where we can go into more depth. Is there a final thought that we can leave with our audience? You know, we'll have your contact information in the show notes, but maybe people should reach out to you when? What's the when? Or whatever you like.
No, I mean, we have clients who come after they issue the token, so we help them in the listing. We have people come at the beginning. So we are, you know, a consultancy company. We navigate the process. We're an independent consultancy. We are purposely not developing any technology. So we work with multiple technology providers. And we believe strongly in this token, security token. It's happening. It takes time. And people should not be rushing things. Within 2 to 3 years, you will see this is a very solid environment. So people who are interested, they should look at it now because it gives them an advantage. It's cheaper to do it now from a marketing perspective. Later on, it will be more crowded.
Yes.
So if people are interested, they can reach out to us or any of the players in the market. And we work with...
They should reach out to you probably, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
It's a wise choice.
For that, absolutely.
Fantastic. Mohammed, I want to thank you so much for taking the time. I know you're very busy and it's the beginning of the week, but we're honored to have you on the show. And I'm going to be uploading this right now, actually. So I'm going to stop the recording and say thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me. Yeah.